Oh, do you have to pee or anything like that?
No, I'm good right now.
Now you're good?
I'm good. I'm good. Yeah.
All right, cool. All right, so today on the Feeble Minded Podcast, I'm joined by legendary skateboarder Matt Bell. Thanks for coming in, Matt.
No problem. No problem.
Oh, yeah. So I wanted to talk with you about skating in the 90s because that's when you like your main career existed.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I started skating in 85.
Oh, shit.
And then, like, I stopped skating actually in 91 ish. And then I started skating again in 94.
Okay.
Yeah. And then from there on, it was kind of like, you know, I kept skating since then. But
damn.
I had a little break.
How'd you get into skating?
Oh, man. I was in math class in junior high school. And this kid, Mike Graham, this kid, James Donley, which is Justin Donley's uncle.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were all sitting in front of me looking at a surf magazine. And I was kind of like being nosy, like over their shoulder, like, you know, and I was like, I saw an ad for Madrid skateboards. And I think it was Mike Smith doing like a hand plant. And I was like, oh, that was pretty cool. What's, like, you know, what's that about? And they were like, oh, skateboard, this and this and that. And they were like, yo, you should get a board. And then I remember like Christmas came and I had a choice between getting a sheepskin jacket, which back then was like the shit.
Yeah.
Or getting a skateboard.
And damn.
I remember going back and forth with my grandfather for a while. And finally I said, you know what? I'm going to get the board. And it was funny because I left to go on Christmas vacation. I was like hip-hop kid, Lee jeans, you know,
yeah.
Whatever, break dancing. I came back after Christmas break and I was wearing like palm tree Vans, OP shirt. I had a board. Everybody's yes. Like, what happened to you? I was like, oh, nothing.
That's awesome.
That was it, man. That was it.
Damn, that was in 85?
85, yeah. Christmas 85, I got my first board.
Damn.
Yeah.
I can't even. So were the boards like square tail back then, or what was like the no-nose on them?
Yeah, I had a Rob Roskop, so I had a kind of a weird tail.
Okay.
Kind of like this, and came in and then came back out like a fishtail.
Okay.
The nose was really small, though.
Yeah.
I remember that. And I had every accessory. I had nose guard, rails, birdie, tail
really?
Skid. Oh, yeah, I had everything.
Damn.
I had everything on it. It weighed a ton.
That's crazy.
Back then, like to get a board fixed, it was like bringing like your car to a shop. Like,
really?
I would drop it off for like a day or two.
So they really?
Could, like, tune it up and like whatever. Yeah, it was
no
crazy.
Way.
Yeah.
Well, there probably weren't a lot of shops around back then. Then.
No, it was just Ricks and Bunger.
Okay.
For
in
us,
Long
right,
Island,
out
right?
Here, but out in Suffolk.
Okay.
I mean, I'm sure there were more out east, maybe, and then there might have been one or two in Nassau, but for us, it was Ricks or Bunger.
So you grew up skating all like Long Island, basically, just all
yeah.
around.
Bayshore first, and then once cars got involved like that, we started traveling a bit more. Like my friend Jared's mother would actually drive us to demos. Like so, we used to go to like, Danny's Ride Away. And place Dr. Bikes was around in Merrick. So we go there, you know, but his mom would drive us there, drop us off. She like loved skating.
Really?
So she would bring us in. She would stay there and hang out and watch us and be psyched. And then, then once Jared got his car, then it was kind of like it was on, you know, all over the place.
Do you remember like what the pull was to skateboarding for you? Like, mm-hmm. was there any like, I don't know, like, that it wasn't accepted or that it, like, was there something that kind of drew you to it?
Oh, yeah, because it wasn't cool.
Yeah.
And it wasn't a team sport. I used to love basketball, but I never went out for the team because I didn't like the pressure of being on a team. Like, you know, like, if I fuck up,
yeah,
you know, it's on me and whatever that. And, like, I liked it because it was very, like I said, it wasn't cool. And then also, you know, back then there weren't that many black skaters. I hate bringing up that type of thing, such, you know, race, but
yeah,
it wasn't. And to me, that almost made me want to do it even more.
Yeah.
To me, it was like something completely different. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, and it was my own thing. And only a few pros I knew. I mean, Steve Stedham, I think, was pro then. And there might have been a couple more. I think Chuck Dinkins was pro then.
What about John the Man Reeves? Was he?
He was after.
After?
Yeah, because John came out in, I think it was Hocus Pocus.
Oh, okay.
For him and Donner. And I remember seeing John Reeves in that. But there were a few. Then obviously, like Ray Barbie came
out.
We saw Ray. And it was a handful, you know what I'm saying? Kareem was around a little bit then. I remember seeing him like in this Powell Peralta like fanzine they used to come out with every month.
Yeah.
And Kareem was like win contest in that. And you see Kareem Campbell. And you hear like Javante and those guys were around a little bit too. But in 85, 86, there weren't a lot though, you know?
Damn.
I feel like after 87, 88, that's when it kind of like, after like 8th Street came out.
Yeah.
That's when kind of you started seeing like, you know,
amazing,
a lot more diversity, I think.
That's the type of stuff that gets me psyched. Like when things are completely new and like untouched kind of area and stuff, that's what really gets me psyched to do shit.
Yeah, it definitely had me psyched.
So, yeah, I was on the basketball team, baseball
really?
Team. Yeah.
Really?
I was like varsity in the 8th, 9th grade.
I can't picture you doing that at all.
I was like, I was pretty good at both of them.
Really?
I probably could have got scholarships.
And play a game
I just
one day.
Would fail. I'm down. Yeah, I would just fail school and like And then I found skating,
mm-hmm.
and I was going to basketball practice and then skating after that. I started getting shin splints.
Okay.
And then once that happened, I was like, fuck.
How'd you get into skating?
I quit basketball and baseball and then just skated full time, eventually dropped out of school. So
yeah, me too. Same thing.
But that pull to skating, like, once I saw it, I was like, I have to do it. I love that. It was like no rules, no teams.
Your own thing.
Yeah.
But what got you into skateboarding?
Me? I think a kid, like one of the kids in my class, came around with a board and he came to my house. I was like jumping around on it. My older brother actually would push me around in the driveway when I was like 5 years old.
Okay.
His board. He was like, he had propaganda. He would always play.
Okay. Oh, had the power.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
Nice.
So I remember, and then when I got my first board, I would pop that cassette in and watch that over.
Damn. Okay. Yeah. That's OG right there.
Yeah.
Propaganda shit.
Yep. Frankie Hill.
Yes, yes, yes.
So, yeah, that was basically it. And then once I got into it, I was like,
that was it.
Nothing else. Yeah,
that's with me.
It. Yeah.
I drove my mother crazy because she was like, Matt, you could do other things. And I'm like, nah, I skate. And I remember the basketball coach, Mr. Todaro from Bay Shore, came up to me and was like, Matt, you know, come out for the team, try out for the team. And I was like, nah, I skate. Like, I couldn't even see, like, pass. It was just like, that was it. You know, and it's a lifestyle. Like I said, it just takes over your life, man. Like, you know, it's not, you like, you just don't skate and then put your board in the closet and then go play baseball, then come home. And it's like, you skate. It's like, you walk, talk. It's who you are, you know, like when you fully get into it, you know?
Yeah.
And I couldn't see anything else. It was it.
Me either, man. I remember my dad was trying to bribe me to pass school, eighth grade. Really? He's like, all I wanted to do was go to California to skate. And he's like, I'll send you to California on a paid trip if you just pass. If you get 65s across the board and pass.
Yeah, like, just get by.
That's it. I'll send you there. And I failed.
Because you were too busy skating.
Yeah, and then eventually dropped out. So.
Wow. Yeah, me too. I got kicked out. They gave me the opportunity. They said, Matt, either drop out or we're going to kick you out.
Really?
I guess so your record looks better if you just drop out instead of getting kicked out.
Yeah.
So I was like, all right, whatever. You know, I just dropped out, just stopped going.
Damn, you know? I didn't know that. What grade?
I want to say, that'd be like 10th grade, something like that.
Yeah, me too, 9th, 10th.
Yeah, because I think once I got that freedom of high school, when I can just come and go, and like, I was like, I don't want to be here. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
I would cut school and skate in front of the high school. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'd be skating right in front of high school, like not in class, same. Like, you know? And they'd be like, Matt, go to class. I'm like, eh.
I had some classes where I would, like, jump, like if the teacher left the room or something. I remember one time jumping out of the window and going to meet James Rires.
Nice.
He would always pick me up, like, third period. He'd be like, all right, I'm coming to get you. We're going to Flushing. And I'd be like, all right, I got to.
Later.
You know, that's it. Every day. So I was like, all right, I got to just quit at this point.
You know, it is what it is, man. School's overrated.
Yeah. Did you end up getting the GED?
Yeah, I got my GED. My good enough diploma.
I got mine, like, I think right after, just to make sure I'd get it, because I knew down the road I would like never to get it.
Years later, I think like 2006 or some shit like that.
Was it tough, like going and like pulling the trigger and being like, all right, I'm gonna go do this.
You know, the actual test wasn't as bad as I thought, but like the build up to it was, you know.
Yeah.
And I just passed. I always sucked in math, so math I think by like 2 points I got past that.
Really?
Everything else I was good at. But just math always gave me a hard time, and I passed that. Like, and so I was like, I got that. I mean, it was definitely like satisfying, you know, because my mother was kind of like bummed, like, you know, and me and my brother Mike both didn't graduate. You know what I'm saying? So for her, it was like, you know, you had two kids, no like ceremony, no like nothing like that. Like,
just disappointing. As a mom, I could see that.
Yeah, she was probably just like, fuck.
It is tough. Like, I understand where parents come from, because in their eyes, it's just like, throwing away everything, you're like not doing what everyone else is doing. You're just not like careers in skating, especially at the time.
Oh, hell yeah. There wasn't one.
You know, so my dad's a pretty cool guy, but still he was like, it wasn't normal.
Something to fall back on. He wanted you to have at least, you know what I'm saying? Like, go to school. Like, my mother didn't understand skateboarding at all.
Yeah.
Like, and, you know, she was just like, well, what do you mean they want to give you free stuff? Why? I'm not, because I think I'm pretty good, I guess. And they wanted, you know, she's like, but then she was smart too, and I wasn't smart. She was like, well, Matt, your name's on that. Are you getting money for it? And I was like, nah, I never thought about that. I was like, yeah, I go, you're right. Like, you know, I'm not getting any money for this.
Wow. But like, and I said, that was what, for when you were pro four?
Well, I was on blue light wheels, and they gave me a wheel. I think I was riding for Infamous then too. Okay. I didn't have a board though, but I had a wheel, which was weird. Like, it didn't make any. Yeah. I don't. It was weird. I was like, it was a weird thing.
But I like that.
Because like all the pros on the team, it was Ryan Hickey, Mike Hernandez, Ben Liversedge. Then the AMs were me, NA, Ivan Perez. I want to say Jones Keefe. I know I'm missing one more, and I apologize for forgetting, but But yeah, out of all the amps, I had a pro wheel though.
That's funny.
So I don't understand that, but whatever.
Did you, let's see, so from 85 till then, like when was that you got, you know, you were getting hooked up and then pro, you know?
My first sponsor was Naked, a thing called Naked Boards. It was like these blank boards you can get from like, I think it was Maryland.
Okay.
And I think I got on first. And back then you'd send like Polaroid pictures to get sponsored. Like you like a
really?
Little, yeah, write like a letter.
No.
You know, I'm looking for a sponsor. And I remember I sent pictures of me on a launch ramp, like doing airs. And the guy wrote back, his name was Glenn. And he
I didn't even think about that before sponsor me tapes.
Yeah, dude. It was just strictly like pictures, you know, Polaroids. And he was the guy Glenn me back and he's like, yeah, look your photos or whatever. And he sent me like one board. And I was like, I made it. I go, this is it, like, you know. And then my friend Jared got on, and then Jared got on Kryptonics, and then Jared got me on Kryptonics, and so that was my first experience like having a sponsor, and then after that I think it was Jab Skateboards I got on, which was out of Jersey. This guy Bill, and me, Jared, my friend Joel wrote for that, and actually it was funny because Bill took us to Lansdowne for the first time. And I remember seeing the videos, obviously, with Nardis and Sheffy skating it.
Yeah.
And I remember being like, and he calls it, and he goes, yo, I'm picking you guys up on Long Island. We're going to come to my house in Ramsey, New Jersey, and then we're going to drive down to Baltimore to go skate that park that Nardis and Sheffy skated. And to us, it was like, those places aren't real. You know what I'm saying? Like, how do you get to that? He's like, yeah, we went there. I remember we slept in the car, woke up in the morning, and there it was right there, Lansdowne. We were like, our jaws like dropping.
Really?
Like, holy shit. Like, this is fucking insane. Damn. But it was crazy, man. But yeah, then it was Jab. And then I don't know, after Jab, I don't know if I wrote for anybody after that. I think, it was Jab, and then Jab had to be like the late 80s.
Okay.
And then I don't think I had another sponsor after Jab. And then I remember just skating. And then I moved to Alabama.
Okay.
Because I was getting in trouble and I had warrants for my arrest and stuff like that. So my dad told me to come down to Alabama and live there. I was there for 8 months. And some little small town. Nobody skated. I was the only person that skated. They looked at me like I was crazy.
They must have, yeah. Dude, I've been down there. Yeah. It's like still like not even.
Exactly. You know, yeah. If you go there now, it's like the land that time forgot, dude. It was the town's just crazy. But they saw me skate. I remember skating in front of the Piggly Wiggly. And I had dreads, like Vans on. And people like were like walking like and would stop and be like, just stare at me like I was crazy. So over like 8 months of that, like, you know, I would be writing home, talking to friends at home. And like slowly I felt like, people that, like my close friends had stopped skating, like Jared, Joel. Joel disappeared. I don't know where Harry went. I think Harry might have been in the city or something like that. And my brother Mike was off doing music and stuff like that. So I came home and nobody skated. So in my mind, I'm thinking like, I'm 18. This is what happens. I'm an adult now. I got to get a job. And I'm thinking like, nobody skates anymore. Like, this is it. Skateboarding's done. So I start working, get a job, start doing other things, getting in trouble. And that went on for about 2.5 years. And then one day on a random trip to California with my friend, with Adam and Ed and some other people, we go to San Diego and we end up at Pacific Drive Skate Shop. And we're sitting there. I see Sal Barbier sitting outside. I was still good with face. I'm like, oh, that's Sal Barbier. What the hell? Like, you know, I started talking to him. Hey, what's up, Sal? Man, I've been a big fan for a long time. And so we end up getting skateboards in San Diego, Pacific Drive. And then we end up going to Lansdowne, to Lockwood up in Hollywood. Randomly just find Lockwood. And dude, it was a who's were there. Like, you know, it was like Kareem was there. Gabrielle, rest in peace, was there.
Damn.
The whole Menace team. Like, you know, I didn't know who those guys were at the time. Cause they were new.
Okay.
But I knew Kareem. I knew who Gabrielle was. I knew who like Rudy Johnson, all those guys. Guy was there.
Damn, yeah.
And we're sitting going, what the hell is this? Like all these pros that we've seen in magazines and demos, all here skating in front of us, like this schoolyard. So then I came back home and I was like, I ain't skating no more, forget this. And I moved to the city and then I remember I was walking downtown by Astor Place and I see a bunch of kids skating. And I see Peter Hunt, who I knew from back in the day. I'm like, hey, Pete, what's up? He's like, hey, what's up, Matt? We start talking. I'm like, yo, what's the newest shop around here? He's like, there's a shop around here? And he goes, yo, one just opened over on Lafayette and Broadway. It was Supreme.
Oh, really?
And it just opened up. So I go down to Supreme, and I'm sitting in the window, just kind of just peeping everything and watching people come and go. And Mike Hernandez walks up behind me, and he goes, Matt Bell? And I was like, yeah, what's up? He's like, what are you doing here? I was like, no, I'm just chilling. He's like, you skating again? And I was like, I guess.
Maybe.
And he goes, yo, hold on a minute. And he called Huff, and he goes, Huff, look who it is. It's Matt. And Huff's like, oh, shit, what's up, man? This and that. And I remember I traded Huff a Tommy Hilfiger spring jacket for like a set of wheels and like some trucks, I think it was, something like that, something crazy. And I remember them being like, yo, keep skating. And I kind of just was like, damn.
So you knew Huff before this?
I skated, yeah, I knew Huff, I knew Keenan, I knew Mike, I knew those guys, like, you know, from beforehand, like, you know, Ben, Gino, all those guys, like, you know, when we were younger. I mean, I wasn't close with them like that, but like if I went to the city, I remember skating with Huff and Keenan down at the World Trade Center. Okay. With Jared, and then I would see like Gino and them at demos on Long Island, and it was always like a mutual respect there. But like I said, I mean, I wasn't close with them, but if I saw them, like, oh shit, what's up?
Yeah, you know? You're in the community,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah, and then I remember just being like, and then I remember hearing like, yo, man, you know, like Gino's pro and Keenan's pro, and I'm like little Gino from Long Island, and they were like, yeah, they go, yeah, he's in L.A. now, they're doing their thing. Huff's pro, this guy's. I was like, come, I said, I'm thinking like nobody's skating. I'm thinking like, oh, skateboarding is done. Nobody skates anymore. Meanwhile, these guys kept skating, went out to Cali. Damn. And the rest is history. You know what I'm saying?
And I was, and like, so you just thought at that time, like, because no one else was doing it, you're just like, oh, I'm 18, like so I got to get a job. Exactly. Like, that's it.
And like my core unit was Jared, Joel, my friend Howie, and they weren't skating. So I'm thinking like, oh, I guess this is it. Nobody's skating. My mother's in my ear. You got to get a job. You're 18. Yeah. So I'm thinking, all right, I guess this is it. Like, you know what I'm saying? I got to get a job now. Like, you know, and like I said, when we stopped skating, like, I didn't look at a magazine. I didn't know anything about it. I didn't know what was going on. Nothing.
It's like I'm the same way. It's just like, I'm on or I'm off, kind of. Yeah, exactly. Like, huh?
And then it came back, and I was like, damn. I was like, wow, niggas are still doing it. And then I just kept skating. And then I remember I moved in with Frank Nadiello on 43rd Street and lived there for a little bit. And I remember him trying to get me on American Dream. But he called up Ali Asher actually from a payphone, and I was with him. But Ali had just filled the team up. But then Ali put me on Big East Wheels instead, because he's like, yeah, I still have room on this. So he put me on that. And then I remember Harold Hunter trying to get me on Zoo York. And
oh, really?
That never worked out. And then I got on a thing called Brooklyn Boards. I wrote for them for a little while. And then I got off of Brooklyn Boards and I went to Chapman.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know you were on Chapman.
Yeah. Yeah. Well,
for I got Chapman deck right there on the wall.
Nice. Yep. Yeah. Glenn Gregg fucking looked out for me, flew me to Cali, flew me back from Cali. And then I left that because Ben Livers just got me on ATM. And then I was on ATM for a while. And then Ben left. And then when Ben left, I felt kind of like obligated, kind of like, you know, I'm like, if Ben ain't here, I mean, the team was cool. Like Edward DeVera was on. Hmm. I had a good team, but like I was just like, not without Ben. I know I feel kind of weird.
Yeah.
And so I told the guy, I'm like, yeah, you know what? I think I'm gonna kind of just fall back. And then that's when Infamous started. And then that's when that whole thing happened.
Okay.
And then Infamous was good for a while. And then, then shit got real.
So how was like the Infamous days? Like how, like starting from there? Like
it started off good, man. Like it started off like, you know, a good solid unit. But what it was, there was too many personalities and too many guys that had been through the game. Yeah. I was new to it. Like I said, these guys knew more than I did. Like, you know, I was still kind of just like wide-eyed and bushy-tailed. Like, oh, I'm you know, getting free boards and whatever.
Yeah.
But these guys had already been through other companies. Like Ryan was pro for Stereo. Herney would roll, I think, for American Dream. So these guys already knew the game. And like they kind of knew what they wanted. And like I said, it was just too many strong personalities, you know. And then Ivan was on that team, Perez, and I think Ivan was the first one to get kicked off. Right before we went on tour, he had some words with the owner, I think, and then he got released. We're like, oh shit, Ivan's going.
Wait, was Fred Gall on that?
No.
I remember you telling me some story about you going on tour.
Oh yeah,
something like that. I didn't know if that was
Jersey. Oh, okay. That was actually at a contest, like a Vans contest, and Freddie was there. And we had a room of Infamous room, and everybody was there. Like all these pros were there, and we're just, you know, drinking, wilding out. And I remember we were in a room, and I think Ryan Hickey's radio got broken, and all hell broke loose and shit like that. But Freddie was there. We were all hanging out. It was a good time. But Freddie was always, to me, it always seemed like he was always on Alien.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, Alien or Habitat, like after Alien, went out, the same thing. But
and what year was this all going
this
on?
This had to be like 96, 97.
Okay.
Maybe like 98-ish. Because I remember I was on, no, because Infamous, I wasn't on Infamous. Oh, no, I wasn't Infamous. And so it had to be like 97, 98.
Okay.
Around there. And then we went on tour up in Vermont in New England. And like I said, you had a bunch of these personalities, like, you know what I'm saying, hanging out. And like, it was a matter of time before it and imploded. And that's what happened. Like, you know, I remember we came home from tour, and I was living with Ryan Hickey back then in Brooklyn. And me and Ryan, we you know, get out of the van, get our bags, we go into the house, I go in my room, Ryan goes in his room, and all I hear is the phone ring. Ryan's on the phone talking this and this and that. And all I hear is Ryan go, yo, hey, yo, Matt, we're fucking off the team. I was like, dude, already? I'm like, I just walked in the door from the tour. He's like, yo, we're off the team. I was like, but we kind of knew it. You know what I'm saying? Because we were like very outspoken.
Okay.
You know? And the owners, like I said, I don't think they realized.
It's too much trouble for
them. It was
too
much. It was,
like,
it was, I
deal with this.
I can't really blame them. Like I said, we were like those guys. Like, you know what I'm saying? We just wasn't like, you know, like, it's just, it was just too many personalities. Like, yeah. I said, nobody was trying to take any shorts. Like, yo, I want this, I want that. I remember like we got sponsored by this beer called Long Trail, and they gave us like 30 cases of beer. And our team manager, whoever, gave us like maybe like 8 cases. I remember we're drinking, we're like, yo, where the rest of the beers at? And me being the idiot that I am, I'm like, yo, what hotel are they in? I go to my owner's hotel, knock on the door, like, yo, where the rest of the beers at? Yo,
that's amazing.
When they just started grabbing beers, like, yo, I'm taking this case, I'm taking this one, you know, and right there, they're probably, uh-oh, Matt's done.
Yeah.
They're like, oh, scratch the bell.
Wow.
So, but like I said, it was fun, man. It was a good time, you know.
Must have been.
And for me, it was like, you know, I kind of knew after Infamous, I'm like, if this doesn't work out, then that's it. I'm done with the whole trying to get sponsored. And this is like 98. And I remember I moved.
So how old are you in 98, like at that time?
Shoot, 94. So I was like 25, 26.
Okay.
Around there. Yeah.
Damn.
So it was young still. I mean, looking at it now, like, young, I mean, I could still probably pursue something else. But I was like, you know what, dude? I'm fucking over
it's
it.
Over it.
Yeah. And I moved to Florida for a little bit with Adam. And then I came back and got a job working, I think at Fridays or some shit like that.
Yeah.
And it was miserable, like I said, but at the same time, like, I really didn't see skateboarding working out, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, and I wasn't even mad about that because I really wasn't hyped on being sponsored. I was never good with that, I didn't like the pressure of it, like the having to perform and be like, oh, that's so-and-so. And get people like eyeballing you and shit.
Yeah.
I didn't like
it. It's something I've worked at, like, over the years because I've always just, I don't know. Always felt uncomfortable, always, like, you know. And as I got older, like, one time I had a S demo,
okay,
right? And Joe Bragan hooked me up to go up there to, like, skate with the S team. And I drove all the way upstate, and I ended up not even skating. Because I was like, oh, I don't want to be the dude that, like, wants to get sponsored, that jumps in the demo,
the thirsty guy,
you know? And I was just like, what? Like, throwing away my opportunities because of things like that. Yeah. Like, I was scared. So now I try to, like, face them, but...
overthinking.
It's still...
that's what it is, overthinking.
It is, it's like, overthinking.
Instead
that's
of just
it.
Skating, having fun, like, you know, I lost touch of that. And it was like, everything was like, oh, great. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't like it. So, to me, it kind of worked out better for me anyway. Because, like I said, I wasn't good with that whole under... You know, I never filmed. That's why if you look at... from, like, people ask, like, yo, any videos you met? I'm like, I never liked filming. I always got nervous and was like... and I always felt bad for the cameraman.
Me too.
Over and over again. Then something in my head.
I'll apologize for like 2 hours straight. Exactly. I'm sorry. One more. Sorry. No, seriously. One more.
Seriously. One more. Yeah, I hated that. So I was just like, you know what? So everything that I got on film was like me being somewhere and having a good day, a moment, and somebody just happened to catch it and like, yo, I'm gonna film it. And me not planning it. Like, yo, we're gonna go here.
Yeah.
And I'm gonna get this trick. I could never do something like that. It was just, I would have been here, you know? And so for me, like, how do you have a career in skateboarding if you're not, if you can't even film? Because like I said, I tell people all the time, I'm like, you have your contest skaters who that's their shit and they can go in a contest and just crush it and black out. And you have guys who don't do that, but they're still awesome pro skaters, but like they film video parts that are sick. I wasn't either one. I couldn't go in a contest because I didn't like that.
I don't think
that.
I was either one either.
And I couldn't film because, I was very just kind of like, I could take a mean Polaroid though.
Yeah. Got a stack of Polaroids.
Yeah, got a stack like this and that, but that's it.
That's funny, man.
So it's all good, though. You know, I appreciate the experience, you know, that I did have. I got to skip some ill people, you know.
What do you think was, like, one of the most valuable things you learned just from being involved with skateboarding over the years? Or, you know, like, tough question.
Yeah, it is tough.
Yeah,
I guess be true to yourself and stick with your passion, which I didn't do. I listened to outside sources telling me, oh yeah, you got to do this and that. Instead of just kept skating, like, you know, even if my close friends didn't do it anymore, I still love skating. I just feel like, oh well, these guys don't do it.
Yeah.
I could have looked a little further and found. I remember actually one time we were driving on Old Country Road, me and Jared and somebody else, and we were looking like going to something like reggae something, which I don't even like reggae, so I don't know why I was going. But and we were driving down Old Country Road, and we got lost, and we passed a supermarket, and we see a bunch of kids skating. So we pulled over to ask, you know, to talk to them, to ask them for directions. It was Gino, Keenan. I don't know if Huff was there, but Eric Rossetti, all these guys skating, parking lot. And I was like, oh, shit, like, oh, shit, what's up? And like, oh, we talked for a minute. What's up, you guys doing? And they were like, oh, you guys skating again? And we were like, nah. Like, you know, like we're too cool. We're like, nah, chill.
Yeah.
And to this day, I wish I could. I would have, like, not got back in that truck and just stayed there with them and started skating again at that moment. But hindsight's 20/20, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
But
it's weird. You can't realize some of that stuff till later. I mean, for me at least, I was getting distracted by the same things or people, mm-hmm. people's opinions. Yeah. You don't really realize it. It's very big time. Subtle, you know?
Yep.
It's only when you get older, you're like, wait.
Big time.
Just done what I like.
Exactly.
Was into,
I did it anyway.
You know, it feels great.
I did it anyway. Yeah. I came back to it, but instead it's just, you know, my mother in my ear. I'm looking around at other friends who got jobs, not all getting cars, and I'm fucking, you know, I'm just like, maybe I need to just grow up and just that. And I should have been like, nah, fuck that. I want to skate. Like, you know what I'm saying? I should have been like, yeah, you guys don't skate no more, but I'm going to go skate and do this still and not try to be fucking, you know.
It's funny. That was my, like, my whole life, it was just dealing with that shit. It was, because it still wasn't really accepted when I was, you know,
skating?
32. Yeah. Okay. So, you know, every girlfriend was just like, what are you doing? Make more money.
Not in the beginning, though, right? They were like, oh, you skateboard?
Yeah, in the beginning,
awesome.
It's cool.
That's
right,
awesome. And then 6 months in, why do you guys skate so much? Why do you guys skate so much?
Right. Yeah, and then, you know, so I would lose girlfriends over the years mm-hmm. just because I would, you know, I was focused on skating. Like, I love that more than anything. Wasn't going to get some job to get things I didn't really care about.
Exactly.
And it just wasn't my thing, but. Yeah, all your peers and, like, people you work with, everyone, you feel that pressure of it, or I did at least for years. So
100%.
It's cool. I got away from it for, like, 2 years, and then...
Yeah, because I knew for a while, like, you went on a hiatus.
I got injured.
Oh, okay.
So so I just started drinking, you know, more talking about skating, stuff like that. And then, once I quit drinking and I got back into it,
I'm
like that same little kid that didn't listen to anyone again. I'm just like, all right, I'm doing.
Killing it too,
doing,
man.
Yeah, it's
killing
fun,
it.
You know?
50 states? Crazy. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's crazy, dude. That's like legendary shit, man. That's like.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's crazy shit, dude. I think, like, when we thought about it, and I was like, dude, that's fucking insane. Because you got to travel, the hours you got to travel, get to these spots, and then come up with a new trick each state to try, and you got to land it in a certain amount of time.
Yeah.
Because you have to get to the next state. To do something else.
And then edit the video, then, like 3 hours of raw footage every day.
So that's fucking insane, dude. So
thank you.
Kudos.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Kudos to you for that, man. That's crazy.
Yeah, it was.
What's the next one? I think Europe should be next.
Maybe. Some of the people have been tossing around every country.
Yeah, you should do that, man.
We'll see. It's a long life. We'll see, though. I might be down.
That's what's up, man. Mm. That's what's up.
So, you know what? It's cool to see you because you transferred into jiu-jitsu now, like channeling your energy into, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel like that's a cool...
It's a good outlet.
Yeah, it's just something to be focused on also. Like, is it comparable to skateboarding?
For me, because I looked at it like, you know, it's the same thing. It's like, it's not a team thing. It's you. And it kind of like, for me, it gives me the same high as skateboarding because I'm learning. So everything's new right now. Skateboarding, I feel like, you know... Like, I have fun when I skate. It's cool. It feels good. But, like, I'm definitely on the decline. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not learning new tricks. I'm not, and probably because I'm not really pushing myself to do it anyway.
Well, the excitement level. Like,
exactly.
That initial, you know.
Yeah, I don't have
to get
anymore.
That back again.
Like, I have fun with skate. Like, I know a little manual here and there. Cruising around feels good. But I don't push myself anymore to do anything crazy. But jiu-jitsu, like, every day you go, it's like, you know, learning something new. And it's humbling. Like, you know, and, like, and skateboarding made it easier because skateboarding is very humbling. Because of failure and like trying a trick over and over and over and failing something like not even getting a trick and with
for
jiu-jitsu,
years I've tried tricks
and jiu-jitsu is the same thing. It's like you got a guy, you know, half your size who's fucking beating the shit out of you and you're kind of like, what the fuck? And you just, like I said, you just get getting submitted, getting controlled, and you just kind of figure out, you know, it's problem solving. It's like, I gotta figure this out. Like, you know,
I never thought about that. The skateboarding has the humbling element to it, because you don't just jump into it and, like, you can get the ball in the hoop. You, a lot of times, you're failing for like 6 months before you get a trick, like,
miserably.
Not even getting anything
miserably. And so that made it easy because jiu-jitsu is like, if you can't, I watch guys come in the gym who are all, like, you know, big and tough, and they come in there and I watched them get submitted by a smaller dude and they didn't come back.
Really?
So so you gotta, like, and for me, like I said, so for me it was very easy for that, because, like, to me, like, one, like, you know, when that happened to me, it made me more intrigued to learn. Like, damn, how did you do that?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I didn't get bummed. I was like, yo, how to?
Yeah,
I'd rather
that's
learn
crazy.
Here in this gym than running to you in the bar. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, hey, what's up? I'm going to push you. And then, you know, my arms behind my neck and my head. And I'm like, I'd rather learn. You can kick my ass in the gym. You know what I'm saying? So it made it a lot easier from skateboarding to jiu-jitsu because I was already humbled from skateboarding.
Yeah.
So going in there was like, and I got to find fun in it. Like, when I lose, I kind of like laugh. It's kind of like, that was awesome. Like, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you know, cause
I've heard that's where all, like, the greatest experiences come from.
Your failures.
Jiu-jitsu, when you fail, or in anything really in life. Yeah. It's like when you fail, A humbling moment. Oh, you got to like rebuild
you
everything.
Sit there, you're like, damn, I thought I was good. I thought I was getting better.
Yeah.
Just got to beat the shit out of me.
That's funny.
But it's fun, man. Like I said, I told you, you should get into it, man. You like it.
I know. That's why I'm asking. I'm intrigued.
Yeah, because I know you have that noodle up here, man. It's more this than this.
Really?
It's thinking. It's chess. You know what I'm saying? You're thinking one or two moves ahead of them, and you're setting them up. Like they might think that you're giving them something, but meanwhile, yeah, I'm on purpose because I want you to do that so I could do this. You know?
Okay.
So it's cool.
Oh, okay. So it is kind of like chess.
Oh yeah, big
time.
Big time. Big time.
Yeah, I've been interested in it since you started telling me about it, and just that like. The element of like the channeling your discipline.
Okay,
that's what I was looking for. Discipline. Like I don't know. It just seemed so intriguing.
Dude, come down, man. Come down. Yeah. Just come down and watch if you want to. And bring Steve with you too. I want to bring Steve back. You heard that, Steve? Come on, Steve.
You know. That's awesome.
Yeah, no, it's good.
Is there anything you learned from doing that? Was it been a year or two?
But so I've been training?
Yeah.
I've been training for almost 5 years now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah, but I started training in 2014.
Wow.
I started training, yeah.
And any, like, eye-opening moments or, like, something learned about yourself in that process?
Yeah, I learned that I don't quit as easy as I thought I did. You know what I'm saying? Because, like, it's the first thing that I've ever done besides skateboarding that I actually stuck with. Mm. You know, like, everything else I try that. And like,
yeah.
It's the first thing that I've done, and, like, I've done it just as much as I did skating. And I had the same passion. Like, I'll go home and I'll watch, like, a video of jiu-jitsu, like I watch a skate video.
Yeah.
Like you know, look at it and I pause it. Like,
yeah.
You know, slow-mo, move. Like, to me, it's a trick. So that's why my mind works like it's like a skateboarding. I'll rewind it, look at it again, slow-mo it. And so, yeah, so now, but definitely just, I figured that, you know, I can do something if I really want to. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. To me, that's, like, what it's about. It's, like, being able to find that one thing that piques your interest that you could just be, like,
that's
all
what
in about. Put you in like just a better mind state. You feel better. You're more 100% focused, driven.
It definitely did, man. I thank Steve for that too.
Yeah,
he made fun of me because I was doing Krav Maga, and he was like, "What are you doing, Krav Maga? It's not like when you like poke people's eyes." And I was like, "Nah, it's legit. It's cool." He's like, "Come train jiu-jitsu with me," and I was like, "All right." And
wait, what's Krav Maga?
Krav Maga is like an Israeli, I think, military. It's legit. You know what I'm saying? It's more all around. It's like stand up. There's some grappling in it. It's good. Like I used to go with Spanish Mike's brother, Chris.
Okay.
To his spot over in Comac.
All right.
I used to go there. And then I moved out east a little bit for a little while. And then this is when Steve came up to me. And I was like, you know what? I'll go with you. And I went to jiu-jitsu. And that kind of just piqued my interest more. And I was like, yo, this shit is dope. Like,
first time?
First time I ever did it, yeah.
First time you were there, you were like, oh.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, the guy was freaking. I remember I was wearing like shorts and a gi top. I didn't have the proper gear. And, doing like the tutorial class, and I remember just being like, cause I always liked it. Cause I used to watch like Hoist Gracie and these guys like in the UFC back in the day, and always intrigued me because I'm like, look at this guy, he's all skinny and wearing this like gi and these big guys. One guy wearing like, one boxing glove and like you guys are all diesel. I'm looking like, oh, this guy's gonna get his ass kicked, like you know. And next thing you know, he's like on the bottom, upside down, guys on top of him, and the guy on top is like submitting, is like tapping. I'm like, What? Like, didn't make any sense to me. Like, and so it always piqued my interest of what it was, but I didn't know where to go. I had to pursue it, and then years went by, whatever. Mm. And then, like I said, so when I got introduced to it from Steve, and I got in there, it was already in my brain, but now the experience, and then I learned a lot quickly because what you see on TV isn't what you feel in that gym. Like, it looks very smooth and stuff like that, but when you're on that mat and a guy has his shoulder on your jaw and all his body pressure is on your neck this way, you can't move. You learn real quick about yourself, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? Do I really want to be here or do I not want to be here? Like, you know what I'm saying? I learned, you know what? I want to be here and I want to learn how to do what you just did to me, to you and to somebody else.
Yeah. It's so funny. Yeah, it's so easy to look at something and be like, yeah. It's cool.
Do you feel that shit? And you're like, oh my God, this sucks. You know, I remember like getting double arm bar by my professor. One of the most humiliating things ever. Like this, both your arms are just like this and you just feel like a bitch. Like I said, it's humbling, man, but it's awesome.
Yeah. So, let me see. So, in the 90s, you guys were going, you said with Infamous?
Yeah.
You were going out, like, filming for a video on a tour?
No, we just went on a tour. They set up a tour for us in New England. I think, honestly, this is my opinion, I think that they knew that they were going to kick me and Ryan and certain people off before the tour, but the tour was already booked.
Okay.
So, they let us go on the tour, finish out, you know what I'm saying, because, you know, they had to. And then, like I said, Chad, when we got out the car.
When the car was in park?
My bag was still in my hand. And Ryan's like, yo, Matt, we're off the team. So I think they had it in their head already, what they wanted to do. And I guess I wasn't mad at them. Like I said, I kind of saw it. I knew it was going to happen, sort of. But but no video was being planned. I think after that, they might have come out with some promo stuff.
Okay.
I think Bobby Pulido was on. This kid, Nikhil Thayer, I think, wrote for them from Frisco.
Okay.
A few people got on afterwards. I think Chris Keefe actually wrote for them for a little while.
Hmm. What do you think is... like the difference from filming a video then, you know, like everyone in the van making a video, like that's the only way I would get to see videos.
Yeah.
You know, like cassette tapes to the shop.
Yeah.
Shit like that. And compared to now.
Now it's the internet, man.
Yeah.
Everybody has like, you know, the phone, you can film with your phones now. And I feel like it's just like, you can just, it's right there. You can film a trick today and boom, it's on. It's on today. Like back in the day, like you had to wait months.
Yeah.
For videos to come out and see what the new shit was, because you didn't know. I'm talking about like 6-7 months, so you were always kind of behind, especially being on the East Coast, because the West Coast was really, the ones really doing it.
Yeah.
And so they were already doing stuff months before you even saw it. So by the time you just saw it,
they were already
been doing it for 8 months already, and you're learning it now. Like, oh shit, so then by the time it comes out again, they're already another
New phase. Again. Yeah.
So it's like, damn, you're always playing catch up, like, you know.
Mm.
But
that's true. So there is like, I feel like there's always ups and downs with everything.
Mm.
You know, like, so we get to all learn at a faster pace, seeing what everyone's doing and like
kids
talking about
that,
ideas and all this type of stuff. But then it kind of decreases your sensitivity.
Yeah.
In a sense, you know what I mean?
You see stuff now, you're kind of like, whatever. Shit. Like, cause you just saw somebody do something just as gnarly a minute ago over here.
Yeah.
You know, there's no build up. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, in those videos, there would be builds up to them. You'd see them in the magazines. You'd be
coming soon. Like, you know what I'm saying?
The demos leading up to it. It'd be like this huge project.
You all go to the shop and like wait for it. Cause back then, like, you know, I didn't go to any premieres back then. So you'd wait for it and you all sit at the shop or you'd get it. Like, my friend Jared would always. His mom and them would order like the videos, like, you know, we go to his room, put it in, and sit there like wall wide, like yo, what the fuck, and like run outside, start trying the shit, like, you know. So no, it was definitely different, but I guess for us, but maybe for the kids now, they're so used to how it is.
Yeah,
for them it's just a norm for them, like, you know.
Yeah,
for us it's probably just different, but
for us, right, it's different.
For them,
when
it's
you
like,
grow
oh,
up
normal.
Around it, your brain's kind of used to that being the normal way.
These kids, like, you know, what I'm saying, everybody, it seems like, I feel like every kid now is like good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, every kid, like, is just good. Like, it's like, what the fuck, man?
I always had this idea with skateboarding where it's like, I'll put in work for 10 years.
Okay.
I'll learn all this stuff. And then I make my video. And then, like, say my cousin starts skating. And he gets to start with, and he's younger than me. He gets to start by seeing where I'm at.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So everyone's almost always at a higher level every generation. Yeah.
Oh, but yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you kind of just, like, you got your generation of videos and you guys work hard on them for years, and then the next generation sees all the things you've worked hard on for 10 years and they're just like, oh, okay, I could do that now,
like
in a year, and then they move on from that.
I can't imagine where it's going to go after this shit, because to me it seems like, what the hell? It's like a video game now, just watching some of this shit, man. I'm like,
someone just did a 1260, I saw.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah.
I feel like, I couldn't tell if it was Switch or Red. I didn't know which way the kid even skated.
Probably Switch.
Yeah, I couldn't tell what the hell was going on, but he spun a lot, though. It looked crazy.
It looked incredibly easy for him.
Yeah, right?
And one thing, I watched the old Remembering Tony Hawk's 900 video.
He was like...
Everyone in the world was like losing their minds. Yeah. All the pros were jumping on the ramp and stuff. And this kid did a 1260.
I watched
full 360-degree extra rotation. And, like, one dude was like, nice.
Yeah. I watched it
like,
once.
Good job.
That shows you. I'm getting numb to it. I watched it one time. I thought it was dope.
Yeah.
That was it. Like,
it's like, whatever. Like, cool. 1260.
Because it means the one thing. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I watched those kids skate the Vans contest, those bowls, with, like, no pads on, no helmet. And the stuff that they're doing in those bowls, I'm like, that's insane, dude. Like, just cruising like nothing. Like, I'm like, yo, I don't know, dude.
Yeah, you forget that they're not wearing pads.
Helmet, nothing. Just whatever. Yeah. Like, I'm like, dude, it's just the next level, man. You know, these kids are good, man.
Yeah.
It's tough watching that shit sometimes. Like, damn, dude, what the fuck, man?
Yeah, no, it's unbelievable.
I'm going to do a manual at the supermarket right now.
Yeah, there's just certain things that, like, I feel like our brains won't, no matter how hard we skate, I feel like some of the things will be too hard for us to really
grasp, flip and slip out, you know? Shit, man. I can't even think that fast, man. You know, just like I said, I watched some of these kids, I'm just like, damn, dude. Like,
was anyone doing that when you were skating, like flipping and flipping out, or I was just starting? Maybe.
Nah, people did it here and there, but it wasn't like how. I mean, like, I feel like in the early '90s, there was a lot of really tech shit.
Oh, yeah,
like
that's
small
right,
wheels,
that's right.
And like, it was a lot of that. I mean, it was done on like a lot lower shit, but it was going on, like, you know.
Yeah.
But it wasn't as prominent as it is now, but it was definitely being done. Mm. I feel like day one, did like a backtail heel flip out and shit like that. And I feel like, I mean, a lot of tricks were done. I mean, Adam McNatt did a back 360 manual back in the day. Now, Gene was known for it, you know, like down Roslyn, but
yeah.
McNatt did it across like a manual pad. I remember back like in the early 90s, like a 360 Ollie manual.
Damn.
It was pretty crazy. So
that's tough. Yeah.
I feel like everything's been done, but I think now it's just being done bigger, cleaner, more consistently. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I mean, obviously there's some tricks in there that are insane, but like for the most part, it's all been done. It's just now it just looks a lot better and cleaner. Is it cleaner?
Yeah.
And bigger. And because I mean, to me, there's only a certain amount of ways you can flip your damn board. You know what I'm saying? I mean, right? So, I mean, so it's just going to get things that's going to get bigger, cleaner. But I feel like I'm looking at skateboarding now. I feel like I kind of like it a little bit because I feel like anything goes now. I feel like you can be some gnarly guy who jumps down whatever stairs or some super tech dude or some dude who just cruises around doing whatever the fuck he wants.
Yeah.
And nothing. I feel like nothing matters anymore. Just as long as you're skating.
Right.
That's how it comes.
Even just personality too. Comes into play. Like some people could just make livings that maybe they have a cool personality and a cool style.
And it comes across in their skating.
Yeah, and people are just into it. Yeah. And like brands see that and they're like, yeah, I'll pay you. You're like, whatever.
I was just telling Gino that. Yeah. I'm like, dude, I go, I see something changing in skateboarding. Where, like I said, it just seems like it's people just skate and they do whatever the fuck they want. There's no like, oh, you got to be doing this trick and this is what's cool now. I feel like everybody just does whatever the fuck they want. You know what I'm saying?
That's why I kind of started getting liked YouTube, because it was kind of blowing out all those old ideas, like you have to do things this way or this way. It's just like there's someone that's like someone else always. Yeah. So if you put yourself out there, like someone could relate to it.
Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean? So that's how I just was looking at YouTube. It's just
the era skating I didn't like that much was I know I'm gonna get a lot of hate for saying this, but the jock era. Like the 2000s when they were wearing like when DCs were all like buffed out and shit and the swishy pants and I don't know. Not the tricks. The tricks were fine, but like, I hate that jock look. Like, you know, when skateboarding kind of became like this, you look like a jock when you're on the skateboard. I didn't like that.
I'm trying to picture it. Are you talking about like links?
I like the link shoe, but the other ones, like, they just looked all big and everybody wore like swooshy pants and like, the yellow shirt was big back then. Like, the alphanumeric yellow shirt was
in.
Oh,
okay.
You know what I'm talking about? Like, you know, that era when like, I just like, to me, it started getting like becoming like too jocky. You know, it's like kind of, I don't know. I don't really like this.
When did that era end? Like, what was
I
want to
say? I want to say when the tight pants came in.
Oh, okay, so like that was the Baker wave.
I think when Baker came in, like the crew and all that type of stuff. Yeah. I think that kind of like nullified that.
That was like really, like I was getting into skating, and then that's when I was really into skating, and it was the Baker stuff.
When it was crew, because I remember meeting Fuchs, and Fuchs wore like those gray crew pants and shit like that. Shout out Fuchs.
Huge influence, man, that Baker, that just on everyone.
Yeah.
It was like breath of fresh air, just dudes like being themselves, not giving a crap.
I didn't see that
just
video like 3 years after it came out.
No?
Yeah.
So I'll for me, it, dude. Baker 2G was like.
Yeah, I didn't see that. I didn't see that till like, I want to say a couple of years after. I think I was working at Sauce and people were playing and I was watching it there a little bit.
Really?
You know? Because I didn't like that Steve either. Like, the team was cool. I like Ellington, those guys, but like I didn't like that look either. To me, that was the other extreme.
Yeah.
You have the jock and you have this whole punk rock, like tight jeans, leather jackets and shit. To me, I'm sorry, it's gonna sound corny and gay as fuck, but like to me, I like Rick Howard. Like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It's like, you know, just like, you know, like trick selection, gears not over the top. It's like right in the middle, corduroy, some ill like kicks on, you know, trick selection is dope.
Yeah.
You know, just, you know.
It's a normal dude, not doing anything like over the top.
Exactly. Just like, dude. Exactly. Exactly. But yeah, I like that. So I don't know. And I remember telling my son that, and he was like talking about, I'm like, nah,
he was like in the crew and stuff like
dude,
that,
love
right?
That shit. Yeah. I used to pipe my arms for fuck. I remember one time, I think his mother, no, he asked his mother to borrow her pants. And I was like, you gave it to him? And she was like, why? You wanted to wear it? I was like, oh, you're killing me.
That's awesome. Yeah, man. That was a huge influence on me. I was, let's say, 15 or 16.
Mm-hmm.
And we couldn't, my mom couldn't afford to live here anymore. So we moved to Montana.
Really?
Yeah. She pulled me out of school. She's like, what will it take to get you to move with me? And I was like, so let me just skate, drop out of school, you know. So, all right, so we moved to Montana.
Really?
Yep.
So was it after Tanner?
No. Before? No, I was in like seventh grade at this point. Okay, okay. Yeah. Yeah, something like that. Seventh, eighth grade. And yeah, we had no money, just got in the van with cassette tapes and via, you know, like a little TV. And just drove around the country, went to Michigan, visited my brother, and then eventually made it to Montana.
Now why Montana?
She knew a guy out there.
Okay.
Cheap.
Nice. Yeah.
And that's pretty much it. And on that whole trip, I basically watched Baker 2G like the whole time, you know? So that shit was like, and just the attitude was what got me.
That was always cool about
them. Yeah, you know, like they didn't give a fuck. Right. Like security and shit. Yeah. Just like not giving a fuck. That was appealing to me when I was young.
Makes sense.
But yeah, Montana was brutal at my age. Being like 16 from New York to the mountains in the middle of nowhere, hour and a half to the closest town.
Damn.
Nothing. Like even to a shitty paved road, I had to walk like half a mile.
That's insane.
And I was like learning pressure flips on basically gravel.
Oh my God.
And then,
dude,
like on the weekend, my mom would drive me an hour and a half to the skate park in Billings, Montana.
That's how you got so good, though. Think about that.
Yeah, you know, right, I was skating the whole time.
Struggle, I'm saying gravel road, like, you know, type of shit.
All I had was a skateboard on the road. And, you know, I got pulled away from my friends. Like, all I had was my board.
And how long were you there for?
I think it was about 6 months.
Okay.
And my older brother, who used to skate, and I would always ask him to skate, like start skating again.
Okay.
He was like, if you get mom to move home, I'll start skating. So I was like, all right, I'm doing it. I just was miserable. Like I was just terribly behaved every day and complained until she moved home, which is so shitty now I'm thinking about it. You know, you're sorry, just a mom. Kid. You're like, I hate it here. I want to move back to New York with my friends, you know?
Yeah.
And
she had to understand that though.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
no, she did, yeah. And then we eventually moved back, and I couldn't really fully experience it.
Okay.
It's a beautiful place, you know? It'd be nice to be, like, alone and secluded
go see
and stuff
it now. You're probably like, oh, shit.
But then it was just, how do you go from New York skating with, like, 8 friends after school, jumping off shit, like, fucking that
gravel
excitement
roads.
To gravel roads.
That
like,
sucks,
nothing.
Dude.
Sleeping in a trailer with no heat, with, like, horses around you. And,
damn.
Yeah. No joke. Shit. So then drove all the way back home. I went back to school for like a year, and then after that,
right,
obviously, yeah, it's just
that's
fucking. Nope.
I never knew that, man. That's crazy.
Yeah,
that's crazy. I know that feeling because I remember I went to military school when I was 16. My mother sent me to Virginia to Fork Union Military Academy, and I lasted 3 weeks. I swear I was so mad. I got there. I had just learned, I think, like all the impossibles and shit, and I was like fucking bummed. And I went there. I told her, I go, Mom, I go, I'm telling you, I ain't ready for this shit. And I went, I remember the first day of school, I cut out, and I stayed in my room, I'm listening to Injustice for All, Metallica, eating M&Ms.
Damn.
And all my free time, I was always in trouble, so I was always marching, you know, because you get in trouble, you have to march and shit.
Yeah.
And finally one day, I got called down to the commandant's office, and he was like, you know, Mr. Bell, we've been thinking about it, we spoke to your mother, and we don't think Fort Union Military Academy is for you. They gave me a bus ticket, and they gave me like an hour to pack my shit.
Really?
And I came home on the bus, and I remember my mother was so upset and bummed. She didn't talk to me for 2 weeks, like just in the house, and like she didn't say anything to me
really?
For 2 weeks, yeah. But I guess I felt bad. I mean, she got some of her money back, you know, but I just felt, I just knew, 16 years old, dude, you got me in the middle of nowhere, Fort Union Military Academy. I'm not a military type of person. My personality, I just don't do good with
you
somebody in my face yelling at me. Especially a kid like younger than me, because you have like a medal on your collar, you're more ranked, and I have to like, salute you and whatever, that ain't going to work for me.
Yeah.
You know, and so I was like, and getting up at 5 a.m. to go out and like the flag getting raised, I'm half asleep. Like everybody else is like all up. I'm like dozing off and shit. Like I'm like, this ain't gonna work.
It's
man.
Funny, you know, I'm still kind of that way too.
Oh yeah.
It's like I've tried to like be more normal, like not but any type of authority, even the littlest bit, just gets under my skin,
dude,
man. The crazy like, littlest bit.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like,
like I should be like outgrown this, but like I just I'm taking it to the grave.
Because you know what it is, man. Like growing up with my friends and stuff like that. Like the one key rule that we always had was like, don't ever let anybody try to play you. And to me, like you tell me what to do is you trying to play me.
Yeah.
So when it happens, like I said, to me, I'm always like, yo, don't tell me you do anything. Ask me. It's just different. And to me, that's how it should be anyway. Like don't tell me, yo,
100%.
Matt, do this. Say, hey, Matt, can you do me a favor? Because I do the same thing.
Yeah.
But to me, I just have that, like, you know, like, don't let anybody ever try to fucking play you.
Yeah.
And I've been wrong plenty of times, like, just having that in my head. but I've probably always, like jumped the gun and reacted when I shouldn't have. But so yeah, I just have a hard time with authority.
That's
man.
A good
like,
point. Know. I guess it's a lot of the times people that aren't, they're not aware. Like they're ordering you around, but they're not like.
Yeah.
I feel like I'd feel terrible. It's just not the way I behave. Nah, it's just like,
exactly.
Hey man, we're equals. So
exactly. Let's have a title.
No matter where we are in any system, it's just like, hey, I'll do this with you, but I need help. Like,
exactly.
I would be on your level.
Exactly, dude. Yeah. And like, I feel like people like they get a title.
Yeah.
And it gets to the head, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I have a hard time with that because I'm the type of person where, like, even at work now, like, you know, if I see something that needs to be done, I'll just do it.
That's what, yeah.
If I, like, I'm not going to walk past a table that needs to be bussed and go find the busser.
Right.
I'll just bust it myself.
Never, yeah.
And I'm not mad about it. I'm not like, oh, I'm doing your job. And it's like, oh, you know what I'm saying? Because I'm sure there are things that I miss and slip up about that somebody else probably does
exactly.
too. Like,
you realize it's just kind of a network. And
exactly.
Like, all right, I'm part of this. Like, we're a team. Like, exactly. We're all, right.
I'm going to go find you. Like, yo, go bust freaking 15 over there. Like, nah, if I saw it and I have the time to do it, I'm going to do it myself. Like, you know? And some people aren't like that. Some people like that authority to be like, yo, hold this, you know, go over there. And like that micromanaging bullshit.
Yeah.
I'm just not like that, you know, at all. So.
Yeah, me either. I've gotten to deal with it a little better over the years. But
yeah, it's tough.
Yeah. It's tough.
But like I said, with our mentality, you know.
It's funny. I feel like I'm faced with those types of situations often. Like it's almost, I feel like the way that you are, you constantly get thrown things that you're the opposite of.
Mm.
It's like life challenges. They almost just keep happening.
It's a test, yeah.
Yeah.
I believe that. Every day is a test, man. But we're still here, Chad.
We you know are.
We're still here, man.
Still
I'm sure,
pushing, man.
I'm sure people counted us out a long time ago.
Yeah, if you would have told me, like, I don't know, even when I was 26, that I would have been on YouTube.
Yeah.
I'd be like, you're out of your mind.
Yeah.
I didn't have a cell phone.
Yeah, that's right.
You know what I mean? I was
like off the grid, dude.
Exactly.
Like, I remember seeing you, and you'd be like, nah, I got a phone, I got a car.
Yeah.
Nothing.
Well, you know what happened was I just drank so much and got into like philosophy and thinking and just like ideas and what does it all mean kind of. And for years of drinking and like pondering, I never had like materials. So I just gave up materials.
Okay.
And I got into like nothingness. Nothing matters. No ideas matters. No pain. There's no nothing. Like just kind of let go of everything.
Like Buddha almost. Some Buddha
right.
shit. Yeah.
Like to a degree. I mean, I was still drinking. It's not really, you know, but and then I got to a point where I couldn't go any further. It was just nothing, complete nothingness. And I started like, all right, now what? Like, where do you go from here?
Yeah.
And then
what happened? You got sober.
I started to like call my own bluff. Like, so let me try to think how to word this. It's like, I used to say, I hate selling out. I hate caring about things.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, well, if nothing matters, then do it.
Yeah.
Because if nothing really matters, like in life or anywhere, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, then you could do it and it's no big deal.
Yeah, we did because you don't
and
care
it's
anywhere.
Sad, but that was like the first thing that really got me started on doing shit.
Really?
Yeah, if you truly believe that, you could do anything, right? Because you don't care about your ego.
Yeah.
All that stuff doesn't matter.
The ego's
so you
tough.
Can, you know, you can do anything and it doesn't matter. And then I started like going through this and then like battling the ego, obviously on camera and like
tough,
stuff
man.
Like that,
man.
Facing yourself every day. So it's just been like an incredible learning experience
good, though,
and
man.
Humbling. It's
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, the ego's tough, man. Even though it's not a real thing, but it is in a way.
Yeah.
It's tough, man. It's tough. And obviously with skating, with the whole thing with being sponsored, that was my ego.
Yeah.
Big time. You know what I'm saying? Like not being able to skate it. And then, I mean, I think I was talking to you about it, about just, you know, just skating and just like, just don't care, dude. Just go skate and, you know, just have fun. Like, who cares what people are? And like I said, that's my ego.
Yeah.
So my ego's thinking like, well, you know, I used to be a sponsored skateboarder, so I should be able to do, like, wait, you should be able to do what?
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Get over
or
yourself.
Or you are here today.
Yeah, exactly.
Like,
get over yourself, dude. You got some free skateboards 20 years ago. Who gives a shit?
That's it. You're here today?
Exactly.
Like, what can I do? That's hysterical. Yeah. What was
the
it?
Overthinker, man. That's what I am, man.
Yeah.
Like a motherfucker.
Yeah, it's tough to overcome. Yeah. But,
slowly, baby steps. I've been meditating a lot, so that helps a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
I have real bad anxiety and shit like that, so the meditation's been good. And just calming my brain down.
Meditation's huge.
Yeah.
I do like 15 in the morning and then 15 minutes at night.
That's good.
I try.
That's
like every day, it's pretty much my routine.
I got 15 in the morning right now I've been doing.
Yeah,
which is good, man. Like I said, I enjoy it, man. I'm learning the whole thing. I always thought with meditation, it was like your brain is supposed to go blank, and no,
No.
Like you're, it's going to wander, and your key is to bring it back.
Acknowledge
it. Exactly. And go back to your breath. Go, exactly. Right. Yeah. I never knew that. So yeah. When I would meditate, I'd be like, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like wanting to burst.
Yeah.
And now that I know that, now it's a lot easier. Cause like, all right, Matt, you're wandering, bring it back to your breath.
Right.
Oh, Matt, you're wandering, bring it back to your breath.
Yeah.
And so it's cool now, you know?
The ego, it's a lot of times you can't know it until you're older. Like a younger kid, like I feel like any skateboarder that's, I don't know what, 16 to 24, you're still like in that ego phase.
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to see through that whole thing, or at least it was for me.
Yeah.
And that was like definitely the reason why I didn't make it in skating.
Was that?
Like when I was younger, it was just because it's like, oh, it's not cool to be sponsored by these people or to do these ads or to do this or to, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that was all ego. That's all ideas and things you put in your head and like what other people's opinions are.
I did that too.
You know?
I did that too. But the one thing I never got with skating, the one thing that really upset me with skating when I first got back into it was how clicky it had gotten. Because back when I was younger, when you skated and you saw another skater, whether he had a mohawk or an afro, whatever it was, you saw him, you're like, oh shit, you skate? I skate too. Let's go skate. When I started skating again in 94, I noticed that like you had the cool kids over here, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, those, whatever they, you know.
Yeah.
And then, okay, and then if that kid wore like this or he didn't do the cool tricks, you guys didn't fuck with him, you know what I'm saying? Because he was doing these tricks. And I think they used to call him like dogs.
Like...
Yeah, like, and so I used to be like, huh? I go, but he skates. He has a skateboard. We all skate, like, you know, and nah, chill. That nigga's a dog. He's this and that. I'm just like,
really?
I never understood that. Like, you know, I remember Mike Nunes like made fun of me. He's like, say, Matt, we get it. You know, you love everybody. Like, you know, we all skate. I'm like, you know, I laugh. We were like, ha, but
it's true though.
But yeah, I just never got that part of it. Like,
yeah,
you know, to me, like, yeah, okay, he likes jumping down 15 stairs. You like doing switch kick flip backside lip slides.
See,
cool. It's still, you know, it's all good.
Yeah, exactly. It's all same family.
I feel like now it's to the point now where that doesn't matter. But then in the mid 90s, it's definitely very freaking
now,
clicky.
If you act like that now, I feel like people will call you out on it.
Good.
You know what I mean?
Good.
Like, I'm pretty sure. And I was, I feel like the same way with scooters, and that might be a stretch for a lot of skateboarders
that's a stretch, Jack.
Yeah, you're at the skate park. At the end of the day, it's just like people.
Yeah, handlebars on scooters.
The handlebars, the skateboard with handlebars. No, but, you know, it's just people trying to have fun doing a passion.
Yeah, I don't bash them. Like, if I see a scooter guy, I'm gonna say whatever. Like, you know, I don't really get it.
Right.
But I don't get mad, like, oh, what are you doing here? Like, you know, it's just like, whatever.
Yeah.
You know?
Like, but, I mean, sometimes you could, like, people will bully kids like that at the skate park. Not bully them, but you know
that.
What I mean?
Yeah,
it's just
do,
like,
yeah, I wouldn't
who
do
cares,
that.
You know?
I guess I would look at it and just be like, yeah, I don't really get why you're doing that, but whatever, knock yourself out. I'm not going to do it.
You know?
I know guys that get mad at BMXs, and I love BMXing.
Yeah.
I was doing that before I started skating. I think everybody had a bike.
Yeah.
One time. So I could look at bikers and be like, no, like, do I want to share a course with them? Probably not, because it's very dangerous. I saw a gnarly accident at Mullally Skate Park back in the day. And so that always made me very nervous about, you know, riding a course with a biker. But I like watching it, and I see them, because to me it's pretty gnarly, you know, but some guys hate on it.
You want to hear a funny story? BMX, you said you saw a BMX crash?
Yeah.
Gnarly. Yeah. So when I tore my ACL and PCO, I had out for 6 months in bed, like on medicine, you know, doing nothing. It was just miserable. Slowly rehabilitated. I was like so psyched to get back. I did all the like healing properly. Finally, 5-6 months in, I'm getting my kickflips back, and I'm like, finally.
Nice.
Like, I'm a new man. I'm back. I finally can skate again. You know, I haven't been able to kickflip for like 2 years. And I get to the park. I'm like relearning. I think it was like a kickflip disaster or something. I don't know. And I drop in, and a BMX kid, never skated before, rode before, just comes into the park without looking, full speed in, and T-bones me, pins me against the hubba, and tore my MCL in the same knee. And I was just laying on the ground, like looking up at the sky, just like in disbelief.
Was the kid like, oh my God?
He just rode away. He was like a little kid. And the mom, like, I think took him and left. But,
dude. And, and you're out again for how long?
And then I think it was like a couple of weeks. Ended up being like a slight tear, and the doctor was like, you could get surgery, but at your age, like, how hard are you going to be going at skating?
You're like, pretty fucking hard, man.
Yeah, you know, and I was just like, it wasn't worth it to get the surgery.
Yeah.
And it still kind of aches nowadays.
Dude, you wear like a brace or anything?
No, but it drops.
I it's worse for it. You wear the brace because it gets dependent on that. It doesn't get his strength back.
No, it definitely, like, if I'm flicking my board
You flip your board still?
I try.
I haven't flipped my board since Trilogy.
I try. Actually, you know what? I could really only flip it on a mini ramp.
Okay.
Yeah, if something about there, I don't have to like pop. It's just like a cheat. Dude, but yeah, you got.
I have
on
the worst
kick
loose, dude. The worst right now, dude. It's embarrassing.
That's funny, man. Yeah, I've never had a good kick flip. And then that was one thing I was, when I got my knee surgery, I was like, I'm going to learn kickflips good. I was like so psyched to like learn them the actual like good way.
Off to like a nose flick and catch up the back foot.
Yeah, I wish. And that kid quickly popped that bubble.
Yeah, I got straight rocket flips right now. It's terrible.
Me too, man. It's brutal.
It's bad. It's a basic trick, but you can lose that shit quick if you don't do it consistently.
Yeah.
It's a basic trick. I mean, I know how to do it in my head.
Yeah.
But just the coordination with my legs in my head, just like I said, it's just.
So it's funny because on that trip across America, I did a kickflip blunt, kickflip out.
Okay, yeah, I think I saw.
And like, you asked me to kickflip a pyramid, and that's not happening. That is not happening for hours, days. I don't know about maybe even weeks.
I've never even done that over here.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I'll not only tray flip it, but a kickflip, like, dude, no, right? That's going to take a long time to.
It's
get
weird,
that
man.
Down. So it's funny, yeah.
To me, the hard trick on flat was a backside kickflip. I don't know why. To me, it's just such a hard trick to do, like, and to keep your speed and like, do it, like, and land backwards. Like, some people do it and they slide a little bit, but
yeah.
To do it, like.
Like a full,
like a
in
full,
the air rotation.
Yeah,
boom, yeah.
Land backwards. I don't know why. It always felt weird to me. Now going over something was easier.
Yeah.
But just to do it on flat ground, just cruising, it always felt like, I don't know.
That's one of the tricks I couldn't get back still. Backside flip.
Yeah.
Yeah, because, I don't know, something. It's got like a weird flick the way with my injury, but when I was younger, it was something like a go-to trick.
How about tray flips? I can't, dude.
No.
I mean, me neither. I watched so many tutorials on that shit.
Off, but like,
I could do it like the back in the day way. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
I could land with my feet like together.
Exactly. But to do it like they're like, I watched so many tutorials on like, yo, it's all on the back foot. I'm like, dude, for some reason, this is not computing with my brain.
Yeah.
The scoop and all that type of shit. Like, I
missed that boat with like the front foot on it, the back foot back
shit,
and shit.
Dude.
I can't do any trick like that. Dude, maybe a shove it.
Yeah,
that's about
pop,
it though.
Ed Durant could do good pop shoves like that. We could pop and like catch it with his front foot. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but the tray flip, man. Like, and Adam Sinazic, he can get out of bed and do a tray flip to this day still.
Really?
He just knows how to do it. I get so mad. I'm like, dude, how do you? He just knows how to do it. Like, I just can't. I could do it when it first came out.
Yeah.
But then when it got advanced, it started getting poppy and floaty. I have no idea.
Yeah.
And you figure, remember, yo, man, with your long legs, you can like, anybody can teach me, man, help, please, because I ain't getting it.
Yeah. But I'm going to need the same tutorial,
yeah,
too,
please, man.
I'm not.
It's tough.
That's funny. So you thinking about getting back on the board or what? You come skate with me? Yeah,
I've been on the board. I told you.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Before I went to England, I've been skating every morning out of Hempstead. I go on dolo missions.
Oh, really?
I go out at like 9 in the morning.
The morning missions are the best. Like, just no one's there, still cool out.
Dude, come if like, you want. Hempstead, dude, come meet me out there.
All right.
Like I said, for you, it's dope because all these quarter pipes and shit transition. I've been skating out a little bit. The one time I met up with the Rons, with Bobby Izzo, with Regan.
Gino ever come out there?
He's been there, not with me, though.
Okay.
Not with me, but I told him that I've been going there, and like he was psyched.
People always come up to me and tell me, like, I'm not even really good friends with Gene. I met a couple of times, but they always tell me, like, that they always see him at Bethpage early in the morning.
Oh, yeah.
A bunch of people always
say
that, yeah.
He's like,
so I just blew up the spot, bro. I can't go there anymore.
I hate that park, too. He'll hit me up and be like, yo, I'm going to Bethpage. I'm like, eh, I'm good.
Yeah.
I fucking can't stand that place.
Yeah.
I don't know why. It's just
not much
for me
to skate.
Yeah, for my skating, like how I skate, it just. It's not. I just don't know. I can't find a line there. I'm not gonna.
I'll skate the bowl. It's pretty gnarly. You know, mess around,
weird.
But then it's just like, all right.
It's a weird bowl though. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like that wall's fucking scary as hell. I ain't going
on
that thing.
Steep, massive coping.
That's for man child only. Not for me. But like I said, I'll go to Hempstead and I'll skate that. You know, like I said, like dolo missions, and I was just trying to get my legs back. You know, just like, you know, I told myself, yo, Matt, don't flip your board. Don't try to flip your board. Just ollies, manuals, skate the quarter pipe.
Do you get like super sore, like after you go skate?
Not so much. I used to stretch. And like I said, I'm from jiu-jitsu. Like now I'm so used to stretching and shit like that. Not too bad. I mean, I get little aches, like little joint, little knee aches, but like nothing crazy.
Something that happens with me is if I take a break, even for like a week or two, and then I'll start skating like at the level I have been, like 50 days in a row.
shit.
Take a 2 week break. Now I'm like 32. Yeah, I'm like forgetting this, that my body like isn't, I'm not a little kid.
Yeah, you don't heal
I have that
you
little
used to.
Kid brain though, man. Yeah. I'll still jump down stuff. Yeah.
See, I won't do that.
And like trying these crazy tricks, and then the next day my back, my lower back's super tight.
You're getting older, Chad, man.
I know.
This is what it is.
It's hard
man.
To accept.
It's what, yeah, it's what happens.
I'm 40, I still haven't.
I'm 46 like, now, man. I feel pretty good for 46 though, man. Like even on the board. I don't feel, but I'm sure if I see myself on a video, I'd be like, damn, dude, I look crazy. But like, I don't feel it.
Yeah, like, no, I could, like, I'm sure you still have some like, good
yeah, like,
board
like, I don't feel like all like the when like, I'm on the board, I'm like, holy shit. It's not like that. It feels very natural still. It's just my confidence isn't always there. So, yeah. I still have like the baby horse legs where I'm like overthinking, like, you know, I was like just skating like a ledge or a curb, maybe about not even a foot high. And I was overthinking that, like, damn, a 50-50. And I was like, damn, a 50-50, dude?
Yeah.
Like, this is like a whatever trick. Like, but if you don't skate consistently,
yeah,
you know, like
you're not
confident.
That confident in your no. ollie, and then you're like, next thing you know, you're like, yeah. Yeah,
you
like,
land Novocaine and shit, and you fucking.
Yeah, man, 50-50 still frighten me. Like, it's like my ollie's not.
Yeah, I'm not confident, but I'm getting there, though. I'm getting there. Like I said, in that park, my park is perfect because it's small. Like I said, go there early in the morning. There's nobody there.
Yeah.
You know, I think I went there one time. There's like one other kid there, you know.
And yeah, it's a fun park. I was really happy they built it. Like, yeah. It's got some cool little tranny things. And
the only thing bad about it is like, it's like right in the middle of it. It's like the sun. There's no shade or anything at all. But I mean, there's a tree right there. You can go chill under the tree, whatever, and come back. But other than that, like I said, it's pretty dope. You know what I'm saying? I had fun there.
What do you think of like the skate scene here in New York? Like skate park wise, like, do you think there's a lot compared to California or?
Oh, California! I think like there's way more in California.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, we just had this like
everywhere in California.
It's like New York is one of the richest states.
It's getting
the country.
There,
it's just
I
like
it's getting there, but California's always going to dwarf us. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I think the schools out there have skate teams. I think some of them like
really?
Surf teams. Like, yeah.
Oh yeah, you know what? I remember hearing that.
Yeah, like skateboarding. Because like I said, like that's where it's that's the mecca. Skateboarding, like it's part of the culture out there. So I mean, every town I think has a skate park.
Yeah.
Much, you know. I mean, are they all good? Probably not. But I mean,
yeah.
But if you go to California, man, you see kids who aren't sponsored or nothing. Who you look at them like, who the hell is this kid? And this kid's like killing it. And
yeah.
I'm saying nobody because he's a somebody. But in skateboarding, he's like no name person, and he's destroying the skate park. And you're kind of like, what the? I'm over here doing like a 50-50 on the curb and shit. This kid's like flying in the air doing a twist and shit like. But it's just another level out there.
That was why I wanted to go to California. I knew that's where all the skating was and shit. And that first trip, like, just makes you a better skater, I feel. Like, you go there, you see everyone and shit.
And you up your game because you're skating with some of the best in the world. So, how do you not get better if you're skating with these guys almost every day, you know? I mean, like I said, just being out there, man, California was like, to get out there in our prime was like almost like, we were so close-minded and dumb, I guess. We were just like, oh, how do you get out there? And like, meanwhile, just save some money.
Yeah.
No. Well, we didn't think.
It's
was
so
like,
funny. Yeah. It's like these huge, impossible blurs of a thing that you don't even, you're just like, that's impossible.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not in California. I'll be at the Brooklyn Banks today. But yeah.
And it's funny now, a little more clear, older, you're just like, okay, I'll just work a job for like a couple weeks,
exactly.
Save a paycheck, and then
exactly,
I'm good to go,
dude.
And get another one there. And
I've been to California so many times. If you told me back in like 1989 that I've been to California probably over 30-something times already, I'd have been like, get the hell out of here.
Have you ever lived there?
Only for a couple of months. Yeah. I stayed with Ronnie Krieger for about a month and a half. I stayed with Ronnie.
Yeah.
That's probably the longest I stayed out there flat was that time. But
how was it skating with him? He's got to be mind-blowing, man.
Oh, man. That was very humbling. It was very humbling.
Yeah?
It made me realize where I was at in skateboarding.
When I started, I think it was like a popular video was Rodney versus Day One.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And I remember in those blind days and stuff, he was really like,
dude, man, Rodney's. I mean, it was such a random thing too because I remember I had driven down with the kid Fail Hand who was a photog, and we drove down and I remember he was going down there to shoot photos of Chad Muska. And he called up Chad and was like, yo, I'm coming down with my friend Matt from New York. It's cool if he comes with me and stays. And Chad's always cool. He's like, yeah, bring him down, whatever. So I come down, meet Chad. Chad's super fucking cool. And then we're hanging out at his house. And he's like, yeah, we're going to go up to Ronnie's house. He's having a party tonight. And they live like right up the hill in Costa Mesa, I think it was. And I'm like, Ronnie who? And they go, Ronnie Krieger. And I was like, get the fuck out of here. So we go there and meet Ronnie. And like, I mean, Sheffy's there. Ray Barbie's there. Rune Clifberg's hanging out. Like all these... I was like, oh, you gotta be fucking kidding me. So then I meet Ronnie, and then I remember going back to Chad's house, And Chad's like, yeah, if you want, you can stay in Tom's bed. He's away on tour. I'm thinking, like, Tom who? Like, he's like, something, whatever. Next morning, I'm laying in his bed, chilling, whatever. Hear the door open, and a guy comes in with his bags and shit, puts it down. I look up, and it's fucking Tom Penny.
And you're like, in his bed?
I was like, dude, you got, yeah, I'm in his bed. I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. Tom's super chill. He walks in, he looks at me, he's like, hey, what's up? You know, his British accent. He's like, hey, what's up? I was like, hey, what's up? I'm mad. I'm like, yo, you want me to move? He's like, nah. He goes, yo, do you shoot pool? And I was like, yeah, a little bit, because they had a pool table in their living room. He's like, you want to shoot a game of pool? It's like fucking 10 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, I'm like, all right. I'm saying, like, when I'm shooting pool with Tom Penny, and then I am staying at their house a couple of times, you know, and then I would go back and forth from Ronnie's house to Chad and Tom's house to Ronnie's house for about a good month. I think I was there, something like that. And then I went back to New York, or I think I went to Frisco with Theo again. Oh, okay. Yeah, because Toy Machine was filming for Welcome to Hell. And so we went to Frisco and met up with, like, Donnie Brawley was up there. The whole team, Bam, was there. Tim O'Connor. Brian Anderson was actually there, too. He had just come in from Connecticut to skate. He wasn't even on Toy Machine yet. And we were all skating Bay Blocks.
Okay.
And we're skating there. And back when I was down in Southern Cali, I was talking to Chad. I was like, yeah, I want to skate Hubba, this and that. And he's like, yeah, Matt, what do you want to do down Hubba? I go, I want to backsmith it and backtail it.
Backsmith.
And he goes, yeah, man. He goes, hey, Matt, man, Hubba's pretty big, man. I was like, yeah, whatever. So we get to skating Bay Blocks, and we're skating for a little bit. And then Chad's like, hey, Matt, wasn't there something you wanted to do down Hubba? Kind of calling me out. And I was kind of like, yeah, I think so. He goes, come on, let's go. So me and him set up on our own. And we go up there. So it's just me and Chad skating. And Chad does his staple tricks, 50-50, tail slide, all like first try, whatever. So, you know, I get on it, I start fucking around, and slowly people are making their way up, coming up there, you know, and I fucking get on it, I get into a backsmith on this thing, and I was excited, I was like, oh shit, like I got on it, and I remember Ed Templeton was skating, and Jamie was there, Thomas, and I remember, I think it was Jamie or Ed Templeton, and I got into one, I came off of it, I landed, and I jumped off, and I remember them going, next one's yours. And I did it next try.
Really?
I was fucking psyched, dude. Like,
damn.
Yeah, it was. And I got bummed.
That must have been, amazing moment.
But my luck with skateboarding, it gets filmed, and Jamie Thomas asked me, you know, if I was using it for anything. And I was running for Chapman then, so I was like, I go, there's no real video coming out. He goes, yeah, I want to use it for Welcome to Hell for the friend section. I was like, yeah, fuck.
Really?
Yeah. So he took the footage, and so when the video came out, it wasn't in it. And I was like, what the fuck? I was bummed. What the fuck happened? And so, if you look at that video, there's a kid who does a manual across Hubba Hideout, the wall, and then comes down it and shit. If you look in the background, like you see me in the background, it's the same day. Years later, I find out that the footage that he got was too dark. He couldn't use it.
Really?
Yeah. I was like, fuck. So I've never seen it.
You've never seen
I've never seen nothing. I was like, it's just like I said, that's my luck. It's, you know what I'm saying? It's like, you know, like, and don't get me wrong, like that trick was already done. Like Mike Carroll did it. Mickey Raby did it. I mean, so it wasn't, I was a groundbreaking shit, but for me personally, I was like, I wanted to see it because damn.
Yeah, man.
I was psyched, like, you know what I'm saying? But.
That's funny. Yeah. I gotta see that clip.
Dude, it's
out there somewhere.
I don't think so. I don't know, dude.
That's funny. It's funny you bring up backsmith because you were the reason I learned backsmiths.
Really?
Yeah. It was the special sauce mini ramp, and I was a little kid.
Okay.
And I just remember you flying across the ramp, backsmithing it. Sometimes you'd like shoot your board out.
Yeah, hit the wall.
Yeah. And I was just like blown away. Yeah,
that's a fun trick. Yeah, man. It feels good.
I learned them like the same way, and I realized it's because of that.
It's that 5-0 kind of just.
Exactly, yep.
Definitely a fun trick, man.
Damn.
Skateboarding, right?
It's crazy. Yeah.
It's crazy shit.
Memories. All right. Hell yeah. Well, memories. Thanks for telling me all these stories, man.
Nah,
it was awesome talking with you.
You too, of course, Chad.
Yeah,
I love
always.
You, man. Family, man. Family first.
All right. Oh, yeah. I think we'll cut it here.
Signing out?
Yeah, signing off. Yep.
Much love to everybody listening. I hope you enjoy it.
Hell yeah. All right.
Love. Cheers.
Thanks for coming out, man.
Of course, man. Appreciate you, man. Cheers.